Gentlemen, don't start your engines, but hold on to your seats, because this time Across Indiana serves up a taste of the Indy 500. It's all just around the next turn as we go across Indiana.
And get Indiana off my mind.
Well, I was born in a small town.
Rocking chairs got me, my king by my side.
It's getting to be habit forming, isn't it? You're there, I'm here. And we're both about to go across Indiana. I'm Michael Atwood, and this time we focus in on that little oval just off of West 16th Street. What's the town called? Speedway? Of course, during the month of May, all eyes turn to the Speedway and the greatest spectacle in racing, the Indianapolis 500. This year is especially important because it's the 575th birthday. And in just a few minutes, we'll be talking with the honored sage of the 500, Tom Carnegie. But first, Titus Rush starts things off. Of course, each year, hundreds of thousands of people flock to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway to satisfy their hunger for speed and daring. But over the years, more than fast cars and thrilling competition have come out of what's called the greatest spectacle in racing, innovations which started at the Speedway but ended up in your driveway.
With the dawning of a new century came the sowing of what was to become an insatiable appetite, America's love affair with the automobile. They came in many shapes and sizes, simple contraptions delighting the masses. Most everybody wanted to get into the act in those days, and Indiana had its share of automakers.
Right after the turn of the century, Indianapolis was one of the leaders of the automotive industry. A lot of automobile firms were from here, and in fact, I've heard as many as 66 different makes from just Indianapolis alone, and I've heard anywhere from 250 to 500 in Indiana, and some of those were just little outfits that built one automobile. A lot of companies built like horse-drawn vehicles, and with the new technology they thought, well, we better convert here, and so they would put a gasoline motor on a buggy, and maybe that would be the extent of what they did. Other companies were large and churning out automobiles.
With all of those companies producing automobiles, it's little wonder that the competitive notion would set in.
Carl Fisher had this idea to build a sprawling, sweeping speedway. And 1905, 1906, he was talking about building a 5-mile track. Obviously, it was half that size when they built it, but his idea was that they'd have long straightaways and gradual sweeping turns so that the effect would be that you were actually going in a straight line, so that you could run sustained speed for whatever you wanted to do, and that way you could just, you know, to just put it in a nutshell, stand on that until the cars blew up, and then take them back to the factory and find out why they blew up, and then build a better automobile.
Because of the head-to-head competition of the different automakers, innovation sprung up. Chief among these was, of all things, the rear-view mirror.
Ray Haroon, who ended up winning the 1911 race for Marmon, came to the Speedway in 1911, and some people complained because he didn't have a riding mechanic, so he didn't have anybody to prod him and point out that somebody was coming up this side or that side or somebody to check the tires or whatever. So he got around it by putting up a rear-view mirror. Little rods above the cowling, and this 3x8-inch mirror, which he could drive along and look up and see what was going on behind him. And that may well have been, we're not saying definitely, but it may well have been the first rearview mirror ever used on an automobile.
Probably the tire was the most obvious thing to be developed at the 500. Everybody benefits from it.
Firestone, in fact, for years used to use the Speedway very definitely for a proving ground, if you like, and advertise it that way. And they had a slogan for years that I think was like 500 miles on the speedway is equal to 50,000 miles on the highway or something like that.
Probably no one has had as much influence on the everyday car as super race car designer Harry Miller. Miller's cars raced in the 20s and 30s. A Miller-based car engine won the 500 39 times. Miller is responsible for innovations such as the ram-turned intake system, superchargers, inboard brakes, and independent suspensions. In 1925, he raced the first front-wheel drive car. And in 32, he raced the first four-wheel drive car. His aerodynamic pencil-thin designs led the way to a sleeker look, something which hasn't been lost in the streetcar design.
The fact that they put those so-called skirts on, then they started to show up on the Camaros and Firebirds and all that. But the thing was, at the time, the speed limit was 55 miles an hour, and I think you probably had to be going, you know, like with the wings, you probably needed to be going, I don't know, 150, 160, 170 before that would really take into effect. So a Camaro going down the freeway, it wouldn't help it a whole lot.
Other developments include advancements in shock absorbers and spark plug technology. In recent years, the Speedway experimented with fuel mixtures. One year, a car even ran the race using kerosene. Its entire fuel bill for 500 miles was less than $2. Of course, it didn't win, but by and large, Hoosier ingenuity at the Speedway has made winners out of all of us, at least where our cars are concerned.
Listen to this sound. Did you notice that change in pitch? Listen again. That change in pitch is an example of the Doppler effect. The sound of a race car coming toward you has a higher pitch, and the sound of a car going away has a lower pitch. That's because sound is a pressure wave traveling in air. The number of waves that strike the ear every second determines the pitch. The more waves, the higher the pitch. Sound waves from a car coming toward you are closer together, and sound waves from a car going away from you are farther apart. And that is the Doppler effect. The Doppler effect causes the sound racing fans love. And that's physics.
And that just one of the physical principles you'll see demonstrated this Sunday out at the track, presented by 500 veteran Tony Bentenhausen. The physics at the Indy 500 series was produced by a team of Ball State University professors. We'll have more from physics at the 500 later in the program. You can also check out the entire series if you drop by the Children's Museum in Indianapolis. Shifting gears now, if you're a race fan and don't recognize the voice of our next guest, well, then you've probably had a few too many on your visits out to the track. So pay attention now as Tom Beeler spends a few minutes with one Tom Carnegie.
Tom Carnegie began his career in 1942 at WOWO Radio in Fort Wayne. And for 32 years, Tom was sports director for WRTV here in Indianapolis. Tom's also been honored with being inducted into the halls of fame of both the Indiana journalism and Indiana basketball. But Tom is also known to most people as the voice of the Indianapolis 500. With us today at Across Indiana is Tom Carnegie. Thanks for joining us.
He's on it, right?
That's it. Tom, now this is a special year too, because 1991 marks the 75th running of the 500, but it also marks the 45th consecutive year since 1946 that you've been the official track announcer. How did all this get started?
It was propinquity, really. I was on the scene as with WIRE Radio then. There were only four radio stations in Indianapolis then. I think only two of them had sports directors or sports announcers. And I got acquainted with Wilbur Shaw, and he heard my voice on the PA out there, public address system, in 1946, announcing an antique car show that Firestone put on. So he asked me to work. And I worked race day, all of a sudden it's turned over to me as the green flag falls, and I'd never seen the race before. And it was a very long learning period. I'd say it was 10 years before I began to feel comfortable with the men and machines, mm-hmm. the racing fraternity.
Now, in that time, obviously, you've seen a lot of changes in the technology. We've moved from roadsters, rear-engine cars, wings, computers, and so on. Technology's changed. Have the men changed all that much?
No, I don't think so. I think probably there are more college degrees in the field now, but the general population is more educated than it was 45 years ago. I don't think that they've changed. They're men of courage. They're men of determination. To me, there are no losers in the field of 33. They're all champions, or else they wouldn't be there.
Now, you're also aware of course, that this is the 34th and final 500 for A.J. Foyt, which is a cause for, obviously, a lot of fans to be disappointed and a lot of the other racers to be probably pleased that A.J.'s not competing anymore. In your book, Indy 500 More Than a Race, you mention that A.J. reminds you a lot of IU basketball coach Bobby Knight,
That's right.
I understand they're mutual friends. Explain a little bit about that.
Well, I think they both work 24 hours a day for victory. Second place to them is losing. The only place that they want to finish is first. And so there are a lot of frustrations involved in their life when they don't finish first. Neither one of them suffer fools lightly. And I can understand why they get upset with the media, because there are a lot of dumb questions that are directed at both of them. And then on both of them, you know where you stand with them. You have, there's no opportunity for waffling with them. And I like all those attributes, and I like both men very, very much. And I hate to say goodbye to AJ as a competitor, and the fans do. They love him. I don't know who's going to take his place in their hearts as a driver out there. There are several possibilities, but if all 33 would come out on the track tomorrow and walk up and down, it would be Foyt who gets the biggest applause.
Now, while we're on the subject of AJ, you also write a little bit about the old persistent rumor that A.J. would love to own the Speedway.
Yeah, well, I heard him say to Tony Holman when he was alive, after his fourth victory, by the way, at the victory dinner, he just turned to Tony when he'd gotten a pay envelope, you know, and he said, Tony, can I use this as a down payment? Well, Tony didn't answer him directly, but that was in his heart. He really meant that. And then later that evening in the parking lot of the Speedway Motel, AJ and I were talking, and he says, you know, I think that pay envelope was about $25,000 short. He's a businessman, too.
Now, every year, obviously, the race gets bigger and bigger.
Yes.
It's much a bigger business. But in those times, for example, from Lou Moore's Blue Crown period of the late 40s into the Team Penske period of today, where do you see IndyCar racing going?
Well, I think that there's some problems in IndyCar racing, but that applies to any sport, especially horse racing right now. And that is that it costs so much money to become involved in the sport. And so teams cannot afford to go to the 500, go to Milwaukee, go to these other races and get eliminated, fail to make the field in qualifications. They just simply can't afford to. So I think we're just going to have to be content to the fact that there are just enough cars, barely, to fill the field of 33. And because nobody wants to spend $1 million or $500,000 or $3 million and come to Indianapolis and not make the race. And there's that danger, you see.
Now, you obviously, as I said, we're going into your 45th year.
Yes.
How many more years do you think Tom's going to be out there?
You really want to know?
We're going to see you into the turn of the century and beyond.
I don't know. You know, I feel good. I'm healthy. And I have a very deep love of the Speedway and an active interest in it. And every year when it's over, I'm tired and let down a little bit. But along about January 1st, I start getting excited. And I'm having fun. And as long as I have fun and enjoy the competition out there, I'd like to stay, frankly, until I no longer have fun. When that is, I don't know.
Terrific. This is the point of the interview where we put you on the spot. I realize you've got 33 men out there who are all friends, and but do you have any predictions for race day?
I just sort of have a hunch that Allenzer Jr. is going to do it this time. Michael Andretti right in there in the number two spot. Two great names. I would like to see Foyt record number five, but my hunch is Allenzer Jr.
Okay. Well, good. Well, Tom, thanks for spending the very busy month of May, a small fraction of it, here on Across Indiana.
I've enjoyed it.
A little trivia. Of all the names, that there have been two drivers by the name of Howard Wilcox who were not related to each other. There's only been two Wilcoxes and four drivers named Howard, and two of them were Howard Wilcox, but not related. I think there have been eight drivers by the name of Jones driving the 500. There has never been a Smith. The most common name, Smith, there's never been a Smith in the 500.
And that, an unbelievable little bit of trivia from the guy who knows more about the 500 than probably any other person on the face of the earth, the Indianapolis Star's Donald Davidson.
In 1934 through 36, they had fuel limits as to what you could use. It was very, very restrictive. It was in effect for the race and for qualifications. And if you used too much fuel during qualifications, that was a strike and you were given two more attempts. In 1934, one of the cars that had a run disallowed because it used too much gas was sponsored by the Economy Gas Company, which was a little embarrassing for them.
Just amazing, isn't it? And I don't think those last guys we saw will have much of a problem parking this Sunday. Of course, anyone who loves the 500 has to love the classic race cars, which are the products of the greatest spectacle in racing. But Tom Beeler found a man who not only loves these marvels of technology, he restores and preserves them.
Last winter on Across Indiana, I visited Ganassi Racing, looking to buy a used Indy race car. Little did I know at the time what a wise investment that might have been. A few miles from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway is a workshop where Indy cars of the past get a new lease on life. It's filled with shelves containing cylinder heads, camshafts, exhausts, car bodies, and all manner of racing equipment. The shop is called Race Car Restorations, and the owner and chief mechanic is Walter Goodwin.
My dad worked on the Dean Van Lines IndyCar team for Clint Bronner, sort of a part-time basis for 10, 15 years, including the year they won the Speedway with Mario in 69. And so I just always hung around, and it's just really all I ever really wanted to do. I played football and basketball and baseball, but, you know, only when that didn't interfere with the racing. And eventually I just kept bugging Clint. I'd help Clint at Phoenix and Ontario, and that got me in the door. I mean, if it wasn't for Clint, I wouldn't have ever been able to really get your foot in, even though you know a lot of the people, you need somebody to help you.
His racing experience over the 70s and 80s led a collector to ask he and fellow mechanic Ed Bowie to restore a 71 McLaren. Their success caused the business to blossom.
Right now we seem to be in sort of an eagle frame here. We're doing the first and second place cars from 73, and we also have the seventh place car from 73.
There was one restoration Mr. Goodwin is especially proud of.
The 65 Lotus 38 I really liked doing because Jimmy Clark was kind of a hero of mine, and getting to work on that car. It was the car that Johns drove in 65 and finished seventh with, and was a team car to Clark's winner, but that was also the same car that Clark finished second with in 66. So it was a neat car to work on, and one I enjoyed because of the fact that I'd always kind of idolized Jimmy Clark anyway.
The authentic restoration necessitated a trip to England to the shops of Team Lotus, which helped them locate a very unusual item.
In talking to them, they put me on to the people that made their shift knobs over the years, and I needed a little pin, an actual little button that went in the top of the shift knob. It had the Lotus emblem in it, and they just didn't think we could find it, and they put me on to the people that made those shift knobs for them all these years, and lo and behold, they had one in the bottom of a drawer and were able to send to us. So it's just little things like that that help you really make the cars authentic.
Starting an IndyCar restoration is an expensive proposition.
I like to see the car, figure out what it is, and then at that point it's just a matter of sitting down with the person and saying, this is what we need, this is what you've got, and give them some kind of an idea of what it's going to cost, and then go from there. I mean, I have the people, when they bring the cars, they give me X amount of money, we put it in the bank, we'll work on the cars, we use that money up, I'll give them an itemized list of where the money's gone and all their receipts, and then we get more money and go on.
Which leads one to ask, how much does it cost to buy this and restore it to this?
Well, that depends on the car. A car could be worth, to begin with, $10,000 to $150,000, you know, and could be worth, when it's done, $100,000 to half a million or $1 million. It just depends on the car and its history as much as anything.
Some of the owners choose to run their expensive restorations in vintage car races, the thought of which, surprisingly, doesn't make Mr. Goodwin all that uncomfortable.
The things are getting worth so much money, some of them, people are getting scared to run some. I mean, they want to run them, and I like that, because a lot of guys will just take and set them. But at the same time, when a car starts getting worth to be, you know, say $500,000 or $1 million, I don't blame a guy for not wanting to run it very much, because, I mean, too much can happen, and, you know, insurance people have heart attacks.
25 years ago, it may have looked like this. Today, it may look like this. But in Walter Goodwin's capable hands, it may wind up looking like this and be worth a small fortune to boot. So, though I passed on my chance for a valuable collectible, you might consider mortgaging the farm and buy one of today's thoroughbreds before the prices race out of reach.
Looks terrible, doesn't it? But the driver walked away because of the law of conservation of energy. The law of conservation of energy says that energy can't be created or destroyed. It just changes form. As a race car goes faster, it gains energy. In a crash, the car stops, so its energy of motion must go somewhere. The pieces of the car that break away absorb most of the energy. This protects the driver from serious injury. So when you see a car break apart in a crash, that's good. The law of conservation of energy protects the driver. And that's physics.
And if you have questions or comments about our little show, then write to us here at Across Indiana, in care of WFYI Television, 1401 North Meridian Street, Indianapolis, Indiana, 46202. And that wraps it up for another edition of Across Indiana. Have a great race weekend. And be careful out there. I'm Michael Atwood, and we'll see you next week.
The new mown hay, with all its fragrance, from the fields I used to roam, when I dream about the moonlight on the Wabash. Then I long for my Indiana, long for my Indiana, long for my Indiana home.